congregation, you may be seated. Well, Jared and Tiffany, you're here. We made it. Take a second. Take in the view. Take in these faces around you. Take in one another. If this all seems oddly familiar, and you'd be right. A little under a year ago on the 18th of July, I think I got that day right, Jared and Tiffany were married for the first time on the side of a mountain, on the precipice of a cliff in Chattanooga, Tennessee. Now, this day was as perfect as any day has ever been, but there was something missing. That was all of you who sit before us today. And so I know on behalf of them, we're so thankful and so glad that you are all here to celebrate this special couple on this special day. For the next 20 minutes or so, we're all here to honor, to take time, to turn aside, to concentrate on what's going to happen right here, right now. The promises, the vows that Jared and Tiffany are about to make to one another and to God. Let's lean in. Let's be present. Let's pray together. God, we thank you for this place. We thank you for the beauty of your creation all around us. We thank you for this moment you set apart, that you saw long ago when you made and fashioned Jared and Tiffany. You made them for one another. You made them for this moment and the rest of the moments that they'll share together. God, we thank you for the friends and family that surround us, that surround them, that are here to share in this beautiful day. God, we thank you for Jared and Tiffany, the gift that they've been to each and every one of us, the significance that they have had in each of our lives. God, we thank you for this institution of marriage to celebrate today with them. We thank you. Be in our midst. Help us be present to you. Help us be present to this moment, to one another. Help us to enjoy the fullness of life that you've blessed us with this day. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Amen. Jared and Tiffany, the commitment you make today is God's idea. Marriage is not the idea of man. It's the invention of God. Your marriage brings honor to him. You're both created by him and for him, and you are his delight. This moment, these promises, this lifetime of love, service, and devotion to one another that you're about to commit to has been God's plan for you since the very beginning. And it brings him great joy and delight. As in all of life, what matters most is God. With his help, regardless of what life brings, the joys and triumphs, the struggles, the pain, with God, you'll not only be able to keep these promises, but you and this marriage will thrive regardless of life circumstances. All of us here are gathered here today with you would attest that it's God's plan. Can I get a witness? An amen? Yeah? Amen. Amen. And we're delighted that you, Jared, Don Michael Clifford, would be standing here on this day with you, Tiffany Maria Myers, to make these lifelong promises to one another. I'm deeply honored as your brother-in-law to be officiating your wedding today. Rachel and I love you both dearly, and it's been a joy to watch your love grow to this point, and it'll be an honor to watch your love mature and continue to flourish. Know that whatever and however we can support, love, and encourage you, we're here for you, and we will fight with you, alongside you, as you endeavor to keep these promises you're about to make. Family and friends, as our marriage begins, our connection with them does not end. By your presence here, you're telling Jared and Tiffany that you love and support them. You're here by the providence of God and Jared and Tiffany's invitation to witness and affirm these vows they're going to make. This is truly a day to celebrate God's goodness to us all. Moms and dads, you're not losing a child today. You're each gaining another child to love. More presents, more dates, more grandbabies. No.
Here, here.
Jared and Tiffany, your parents wanted me to impress upon you both in front of all of these people as a witness that they all think it's time to pull the goalie, okay? They are ready.
Hear, hear.
Greg and Angela, I know that you love Jared as a son. Michael and Janine, I know that you love Tiffany as a daughter. You have watched the relationship between Jared and Tiffany grow. So I ask you all, do you affirm and support this covenant of marriage today between Jared and Tiffany? And parents, if you do, would you please respond with, we do. Yeah. Amen. More specifically, who gives this woman, again, to be married to this man? to take some time just to remind us and remember the creation, the mystery of marriage, and then just to talk a little about the, to Jared and Tiffany specifically, about the roles God's given them as they enter this covenant. In the book of Genesis, in the first chapter, we read the record of how God created the heavens and the earth. It described how he spoke all things into being. Everywhere we look today, we can see his handiwork. God's goodness and glory and beauty is displayed across his entire creation, and it's all around us. And yet the most exquisite display of his glory in creation is humanity, man and woman. Genesis 1:27 records this remarkable event, the creation of man and woman. So God created man in his own image. In the image of God, he created them, male and female. He formed the man from the ground, and he formed the woman out of the man, crafted by the hand of God as co-equals, as image bearers of God, one flesh, like but not alike one another. Two very distinct yet complementary sexes, male and female, would have the capacity to know God, to understand his world, his word, and admire the beauty of his world. Together and separately, their existence would be defined by their relationship with their creator. God then gives humanity, man and woman, the authority to care for and oversee his creation. And God blessed them and said to them, be fruitful and multiply, fill the whole earth, subdue it, and have dominion over every living thing. God commissions man and woman right here to co-rule. God given man and woman the ability and the mandate to create life, life in the image of God. God's plan for this co-ruling was not to exist separately, but together in covenant partnership. Marriage would be instrumental for human flourishing and the flourishing of this world. Genesis 2:24, where God makes the first marriage covenant between man and woman, it says, therefore a man shall leave his father and mother and hold fast to his wife, and they shall become one flesh. Both the creation of man and the covenant of marriage were part of the creation event. So just like all other aspects of creation, like gravity or matter or energy, the covenant of marriage is part of the fabric of God's creative order that he has set in place. And now God views husband and wife as one flesh. So they are no longer two individuals, but spiritually, emotionally, and physically, they're joined together as one. What a mystery, what beauty. The great poet and philosopher, the Spice Girl, said it best, tonight is the night when two become one. Now, normally at this point in the service, I would ask if anyone present knows of any reason that this couple should not be joined in holy matrimony, to speak now or forever hold their peace, but you're a year too late, so I'm sorry. So in the eyes of God, Jared and Tiffany, you're already one. Therefore, what God has joined together, let no man separate. Let me speak for just a moment to your roles in marriage. The Apostle Paul in Ephesians reveals a mystery that marriage has always contained. He says that mystery is profound, and he's saying it refers to Christ and the church. In other words, marriage exists ultimately to display the covenant-keeping love between Christ and his church. It's supposed to be an embodied, incarnational, physical picture of what it looks like with Jesus to love his church. And you get to display that now in your love. This covenant. Ephesians 5 explains this a little further. Verse 21 to 26 says, submit to one another out of reverence for Christ. Wives, submit to your own husband as to the Lord, for the husband is the head of the wife, as also Christ is the head of the church, and he is the savior of the body, just as the church is subject to Christ. So let the wives be subject to their own husbands in everything. Husbands, love your wives just as Christ also loved the church and gave himself for her, that he might be sanctified and cleanse her with the washing of water by the word. The vows you make today, the commitment that you make to one another, is a reflection of Christ's relationship to the church, and we can see something of the roles and posture you both are to have to one another. Jared, Christ expressed his love for his bride, the church, in complete self-sacrifice as a servant protector, a love that knows no end, a love that would willingly die to protect and serve his bride. And so, Jared, your life from now on looks like one of self-denial, one of serving, one of protecting your bride. That's what true biblical manhood looks like. To lead in such a way that no longer thinks of yourself first or looks to your own end, but a love that looks to serve and protect your bride, Tiffany, and God willing, the family he'll entrust to you both. Tiffany, the church was to express her love to Christ, who also gave everything for her. To joyfully submit to Christ, her loving, self-sacrificing leader. And so you get to do the same with Jared, who wouldn't want to follow a man who thinks and leads in such a selfless way, and chooses the flourishing of his wife over his family over his own flourishing. Jared, I see that kind of character in you. You are that kind of man. Tiffany, I know that you see it too. Tiffany, the Bible talks of Eve being made from the rib of Adam as a suitable helper for him. And sadly, culture and honestly, the church at times has led us to think that a suitable helper is some sort of secondary role. But when we understand that this word helper is the very word that God uses to describe himself and his love and his care towards his own people, we gain an entirely different perspective. We realize that there's a holiness, a weight, a God-given glory and dignity to your role. In fact, every other time this word helper is used in the Old Testament, it's describing God as a helper towards his people, and specifically how God is Israel's military aid in time of need. Think about that. You get to be a military aid and help in Jared's time of need. And if you know Jared, he's a good man. But that's a beautiful picture, right? There's dignity in that role. It's not secondary, it's powerful. It's dignified, it's beautiful. It's Xena warrior princess kind of stuff. This is the picture of the covenantal partnership for flourishing that God is giving to each of you as a gift in one another today. A partnership of co-equals commissioned to co-rule in specific roles. To go to battle not with one another, but together. With all of your differences, with all of your strength, and yes, because no one is perfect, with all of your weaknesses too. Your marriage is not to say to the world, look, a perfect couple, but your marriage is to say to the world, look, two people whom God has brought together, contending for one another. We're imperfect. Two people at all times will fail one another intentionally and unintentionally. Two people who are sinners in need of grace, but two people who find the grace in Jesus. He is our Lord, he's our Savior, he's our hope, now and forever. As you live with one another in your weaknesses and struggles, remember you yourself are needy of grace, and make sure you show grace to one another. The difficulties you have already faced and will continue to face from time to time in marriage are no reason to walk away. The more difficult it gets, the more opportunity you have to show love. Stand strong together, continue to fight for one another. Together you're better, together you're stronger. And with God's help and the support of your family and friends here today, you will bring much life and light into the world and accomplish all that God has planned for you both to do together as you love and serve one another. You are uniquely God's gift to one another to become one flesh, physically, emotionally, and spiritually. Bye for the good part. Knowing these truths and knowing your love for one another, I ask you, Jared, do you promise here before God in this gathering of family and friends to be to Tiffany a faithful and loving husband? Do you promise to nurture her when she needs care, to believe in her when others may doubt, to share the laughter and joys of life as well as the disappointments and hurts? Do you promise to be faithful in heart, mind, and body, and to preserve this marriage covenant holy and unbroken until the coming of our Lord Jesus Christ, or as long as you both shall live? If so, please say I do.
I do.
Tiffany, do you promise before God in this gathering of family and friends to be a faithful and loving wife? Do you promise to encourage him when he needs care, to believe in him when others may doubt, to share the laughter and joys of life as well as the disappointments and hurts? Do you promise to be faithful in heart, mind, and body, to preserve this marriage covenant holy and unbroken until the coming of our Lord Jesus Christ, or as long as you both shall live? If so, please say I do.
I do.
Jared, would you repeat after me?
Yes, I will.
We're making it okay so far. Let's keep going. All right.
Tiffany, this day, I commit myself to live with you. I promise to forsake all others and cleave only to you. I promise to love you, to honor you, to comfort you, and spiritually build you up from this day forward. I promise to pray for you, to live with you in an understanding way, to grant you honor as a fellow heir of the grace of life, and to forgive you as God has forgiven me. I promise to give myself to you and to be your spiritual leader. The ring I gave you is a symbol of my love and my devotion. With God as my witness, I commit my life to you.
And Tiffany, would you repeat after me?
During this day, I commit myself to live with you. I promise to forsake all others and cleave only to you. I promise to love you, to honor you, to comfort you, and spiritually build you up from this day forward. I promise to pray for you, to seek to understand you, to forgive you as God has forgiven me, and to be in loving submission to you as a spiritual leader of our home. The ring I gave you is a symbol of my love and my devotion. With God as my witness, I commit my life to you.
I just wanted to invite my wife Rachel to come and to say a blessing, a prayer blessing over Jared.
As spring unfolds the dream of earth, may you bring each other's hearts to birth. As the ocean finds calm in view of land, may you love the gaze of each other's mind. As the wind arises free and wild, may nothing negative control your lives. As kindly as moonlight might search the dark, so gentle may you be when light grows scarce. As surprised as the silence that music opens, may your words for each other be touched with reverence. As warmly as the air draws in the light, may you welcome each other's every gift. As elegant as dream absorbing the night, may sleep find you clear of anger and hurt. As twilight harvests all the day's color, may love bring you home to each other.
Amen. Just check we did everything. Dear Tiffany, because of the promises you made today, in front of these witnesses, your spoken commitment and a desire to serve one another and for the rest of your lives, I am very proud to pronounce you husband and wife. Jared, you may kiss your bride. Ladies and gentlemen, it is my great honor for the first time to introduce to you all Mr. and Mrs. Jared Don Michael Clipper. Let's hear it.
Hey, hey.